And action. Hey everyone, it's DrRic, and today's question of the day at the clinic is from Peggy, rotator cuff pain. More on how you get past the rotator cuff pain, but we'll talk about that in a second. So if this is the first time you're finding me on your mobile apps, please hit the subscribe button in red down below, or if you're looking on your computer, there should be a subscribe button somewhere around here, and hit it. Hit the alert button and share this if in case you know somebody who is suffering from the same thing. So I guess I should probably do full disclosure first. This is my 1999 evaluation that I had done at Central DuPage Hospital. So it talks about my rotator cuff MRI, shoulder MRI, and specifically down here in the impression, full thickness tear. It also shows potentially an associated partial thickness tear, and maybe some bursitis. So hopefully you can catch that. I'll have to edit this if it didn't catch. But if you understand the anatomy, so I'm speaking from experience and my knowledge base as sports medicine specialist. So if you understand the anatomy, you might be able to understand how we can move past this pain, because nasty pain, grabbing pain, keeps you from sleeping, keeps you from doing things, makes you focus on it, and then as it gets better, it reminds you it's still there when it grabs you after you do the wrong thing suddenly. So here's the anatomy. This is kind of my shoulder. This is my trapezius. This is my neck, shoulder, deltoid, and arm. So arm bone or humerus, and then underneath the trapezius and shoulder and deltoid is the scapula or shoulder blade. I've divided into essentially just the humerus and the shoulder blade. And if you look at the muscles that sit and control initiating movement for the shoulder, that's what these things do. Rotator cuff initiates movement. Deltoid takes over after the initial movement's moved. So there's three muscles. The subscapularis, this tiny one, it goes along the top, snakes underneath this acromion, a little hook, and then goes down the side. It doesn't have to be a hook, it can be curved, it can be straight, but this acromion is there for functionality, and it sometimes gets in the way. So there's also an infraspinatus muscle, so supraspinatus muscle, infraspinatus muscle, meaning under the spine, and then something behind there, the shoulder blade, called the subscapularis. So this is how, if you look straight on this way, this is how the rotator cuff looks. It's made up of these muscles, subscapularis, infraspinatus, supraspinatus. There's an extra one here, it shouldn't be. Sorry, that shouldn't be there. But that is essentially what happens. And if you have a tear, this is a theoretical tear, it's usually gonna be a tear right here, right where the supraspinatus muscle goes right underneath the acromion because it's the smallest pinch point. The acromion is there because that's where the collarbone connects to this. So the collarbone here connects to the acromion here, this little bump. And if you, those of you who were in Chicago, you remember Luke Longley, he had a big bump because his acromion is clavicle or collarbone separated. Check out some pictures and you'll be able to see how big his sticks out. So he still played basketball. So this acromion is there for functionality, but it gets in the way because it is a very narrow space where this supraspinatus muscle courses. And when you have a tear, it's usually to that muscle substance. And when the tear is bad, it starts to separate because this muscle is under tension. And when you tear it, it comes apart. If you're lucky enough and it's early and you don't do any further damage, you'll have a tear like me, full thickness, but it won't separate. I'm curious to see if my tear has shown improvement. I don't feel it anymore, but if it's shown improvement on MRI compared to 1999, I was thinking about doing that, but it's gonna cost me money to do that MRI, and I'd rather just teach you. So, as I mentioned, the deltoid muscle is responsible for overhead movement, anterior movement, posterior movement. It does the bulk of the work, but the rotator cuff initiates movement in these directions. So if the rotator cuff is torn or inflamed, you can't get past that initial movement and you won't be able to get past to the big movements. Kind of like a really cool engine in a car. If your starter is screwed up, the car's not gonna move. The engine's not gonna go. So same thing with this rotator cuff. Pain in the ass kind of muscle, but very important. So in the case where you have a rotator cuff that's trying to heal up, every movement you do, combing your hair, fastening your bra, pulling up your pants, reaching over, anything else that requires overhead, painting, sometimes extension, grabbing for stuff, driving, anything you do will cause that rotator cuff to inflame more. So the idea when you have a diagnosed tear, even if you don't have an MRI and you just, or you can't afford an MRI and just have the symptoms of, I reached up, I had a certain amount of pain and it's been painful since then, the history is there. Or if I was throwing, my history was, I believe it was a rock climbing accident in 1999. I reached for something, it's called a dyno, when you just jump, grab the rock, and then you pull. I wasn't supposed to do that, or I wasn't ready, or the alignment of the back and the scapulas weren't some proper, and the muscle just tore. So in the case where the muscle tears, usually the body will try to fix the tear. So the body's great. Even if you have a retraction, I've seen some people get by without surgery. Even if the muscle ends have come apart a little bit, you can still heal up. I believe you can still heal up. Definitely if the muscle ends haven't come apart and just a full thickness tear, again, I speak from experience, I believe that we can heal. The question is, how long will you tolerate the pain? Because as that muscle is torn, the body will remind you every time you go to use that muscle, meaning every time you initiate this, or this, or this, or this, anytime you initiate movement, the muscle will say stop, and it'll grab you. I remember in the clinic, I used to have big ice packs and wrap with elastic. Maybe some of my old patients remember, because number one, cryotherapy helps inflammation. Ice therapy helps inflammation. See my video on cryotherapy. Number two, when you have an elastic, it reminds you don't reach over 45 degrees. It reminds you don't grab for stuff, because the normal reflex reaction is, oh, let me get that. Oh, and then you're grabbing it, and then you've caused inflammation again. Every time you ask this muscle that's trying to heal up to do something forceful, you're asking the muscle to work and it's trying to heal up, it's not going to let you do that. You'll probably break the tear or break the healing parts. You'll tear it again. So when the muscle ends are trying to come together, or if they're kind of together just trying to heal up and connect, every time you do something it falls apart. It's like picking at a scab or having a scab on an elbow. Every time you pop the elbow this way, your scab opens up until you keep it straight for a couple of days, keep it moist, and then the scabs get strengthened. Then you can move it a little bit. Same thing with the rotator cuff. First, we do no further harm. So keep it at your side, keep it in a sling, and or sleep in a protected kind of position for a couple weeks, 4 to 12. Yeah, it could be long depending on your medical problems, disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, other things, fibromyalgia. So you have to allow healing. And the only problem with keeping it immobile, the more immobile it is, the easier those ends are to come together and heal, hopefully, but the other joints that aren't being moved become super stiff, which is not healthy in the long run. So you have to, if you're keeping it in a sling or immobile, you have to get it moving every once in a while therapeutically enough to move the other joints, to allow flexibility, suppleness, but not to the point of tearing what you have healed up or what you're trying to heal up. So that's the first thing, and that takes guidance. Sometimes a physical therapist is necessary, or somebody watch over you and remind you. Number two, you have to progress on to the point, if you have suppleness, awesome. Once you control inflammation to a certain degree and you can tolerate more supple activities out of the sling, then I say we start building up muscle. Now, you can't necessarily, I just told you, if it's inflamed and trying to heal up, you can't build it, you can't ask it to do anything, but what you can do is build up the deltoid, because the deltoid muscle on the outside of the shoulder and the trapezius muscle on the top of the neck, this trapezius and this deltoid, there's three heads of the deltoid, thus delta, they, because you're keeping it immobile, are shrinking and getting tight. So when they essentially are tight, they're causing a limited range of motion for the shoulder, which will cause more inflammation in the long run. So we have to try to strengthen those muscles. So number one, do no further harm, decrease inflammation. Number two, try to work on suppleness and not get too tight. Number three, develop, when ready, the accessory muscles that will get you and catapult you to the point of being a star, rock star. So this is where the problem comes in, is it's very hard on your own to fine-tune when the time is right to start building muscle. And then you have to know which muscles and which movements are correct to build muscle without hurting the rotator cuff. So that's why I really need a physical therapist. It takes a lot of knowledge to be able to control this rotator cuff, number one. It takes a lot of knowledge to be able to control the shoulder girdle joint. And then it also takes a lot of experience to move this without causing those other trigger points, those accessory muscles that are also supplementing or compensating, without causing them to spasm and flare. If you're a fibromyalgia patient and you're taking care of a new problem, unfortunately, because muscles tend to spasm fast in fibromyalgia, chronic regional pain, sometimes diabetes, sometimes just the deconditioned non-exerciser, muscles will spasm fast. So when you ask them to do extra work to compensate for this immobility, they'll spasm and you'll have first a shoulder painful, and then because of compensation, trapezius painful, and then because of compensation, other side gets painful, and then the neck gets painful. So it takes a lot of knowledge and experience on moving forward in those stages I talked about without flaring up and moving backwards. So that's that concept of push-crash. If I have a fibromyalgia patient that doesn't have a rotator cuff tear and she's just trying to move past immobility and pain and muscle spasm, it takes a coach to observe, educate, and encourage to the point where muscle is being worked, but you're not gonna have failure that'll knock you down for a couple weeks. So when you build and increase strength and endurance, that's much different than pushing to the point of the brink of inflammation and then crashing from the inflammation and starting all over again. We don't want that pain cycle to start, but we do want suppleness. We do want muscle strength. We do want endurance. And eventually when you have all that and the deltoid's good, the trapezius is good, the fibers have healed up, then you can build up the rotator cuff. Rotator cuff muscles are easily, I don't have any weights in here, but rotator cuff muscles, like a lot of my baseball players, you don't really need that much weight. In fact, usually it's a TheraBand or a 2 pound weight, worst case scenario, a 5 pound weight, but that's actually pushing it. And if you just do those muscles, there's three muscle movements: external rotation, internal rotation, and then elevation. So if you do these three muscle group movements when ready, you can get to the point of building up the rotator cuff. It takes a long time for this tiny muscle to go and develop and get strong, especially after it's been injured. So you gotta have patience. And I think from 1999, for me, it took about 3 years or so to get past the point of inflammation where I can tolerate full range of motion. And it's taken me a couple years, maybe even a decade, to get to the point where I'm now powerful again without apprehension, with great control of my scapula and muscles and control of my fibromyalgia flare-up. So Peggy, good question. Hopefully you'll be able to kind of get a knowledge base about anatomy and the pathology and how this works, and then know that if you do have a flare-up, we rely on anything, whether it's cryotherapy, TENS unit, physical therapy, massage therapy, anti-inflammatories, turmeric, TENS unit, acupuncture. In fact, that's also how I mentioned earlier how I got past the point of pain. I would stick acupuncture needles into my shoulder right deep into the rotator cuff and just start sending electricity with a TENS unit into the needle. And I would be there usually jumping my shoulder in bed, grinding my teeth, trying to turn it up to the point of healing, but not turn it up to the point of pain. So I just remember those days. They weren't fun, but in retrospect, I don't know where I would be now if I did have shoulder surgery. Probably just the same with more scars, but I was able to do it without. Don't forget, nutrition is always important while you're doing this, maintaining sleep as well. So hopefully the rest of you will be able to get a good specialist. They'll give you some options. I mean, if it's torn, it's coming apart, and you're suffering, and you can't wait, and you can't sleep, and you can't work, then you have to have surgery. But you still have to progress on. Even after surgery, you still have to, if the surgeon can put the ends together and maybe anchor in a lip of labrum or cartilage that's flipping, you still have to go through suppleness, strength, accessory muscle strength, range of motion, and rotator cuff strain. You still have to go through those anyway, so why not work on those things earlier? So hopefully you'll get a little bit out of this. Otherwise, don't forget to leave your comments, and I'll see you in the clinic.